Hey, morning punters. Here we are back again at the Emerald with the punters punter, Dan Kelly.
Hey, Potts.
Good to see you back here. Last of our race-free Mondays.
Don't know what we're going to do.
Anyway.
To get back to working on Mondays.
To do our best.
Anyway, here we are. No, good mate, good to be here.
And for my mate Scoot, there you go Scoot. There's the Betfair hat.
When it gets I didn't even know you were talking about the weather. There's Melbourne today, it's 15 degrees. It's going to be 29 on Wednesday, but anyway, busted out the hoodie.
Yeah, I thought it was only right. They put on a few good nights for us. They've been highly enjoyable, Betfair. Yeah. And they've sent us a bit of merchandise.
On the side of the punter, mate. That's us. That's why we... And Scoot's a terrific guy, and so Matty Clark and all of Josh and Pip and everyone in there. So, yeah, no, happy to go and get on board there.
Yeah, so good stuff for you. Not sponsored by Betfair, but we're supported. We're strong supporters.
Yeah, well, the only betting organisers and the buyers of drink pots.
That's it. That's it. And they don't hold back either, do they?
No, they don't. No, great. So, no, happy to get on board there for sure.
How should we start, DK?
Okay, how's the week?
The week, I've had a pretty solid run. I've had nothing outstanding, but been winning a lot, you know, just chipping away at it. And this week, things just went all pear-shaped early on in the week. It was having one of those weeks where just making a few, the combination of me making a few blues and then things going wrong in races and I lost on Tuesday. Wednesday was a bit of a strip out. Wednesday at Sandown, fair dinkum, honestly. I think I had four strong bets on the day. By the time we got the race won, three of them were late scratchings.
Oh, yeah. Well,
so then you're already committed to those racings.
I had a scenario like that too. Anyway, you go on, give it up.
I think I can't remember what the late scratchings were about. The ones when it's track upgrade from good four to good three. I mean, come on. Turn it up. That should be... The stewards have got to put their foot on that. That's just... There was a few of them last week. Anyway, so Sandown wasn't particularly good. And, the only strong bet we were really left with was Real Reward, which, Brandon Stockdale's pulled a terrific ride out of his clacker on the mare, the bolus over there. He rode two horses, one at the huge action.
Oh, the Andrew Sorden horse. Yeah. I backed it at T-Rank.
So we're only at 15s and we're on Real Reward at a good price with a strong bet. And
anyone hasn't seen his Twitter, I'd check. He's... he's a bit out there, Andrew Sorden, and None from 40, Dame Largo, and Big Buddy, and group races, and all that. So, well, he's a bit loony, you know, but what he has done is changed training establishments.
Right.
And so I said, expect his horses to improve.
Where's he gone?
He's just Andrew Campbell's place.
Oh, right.
Yeah, so he's moved away, so down there, and then, so I said someone said, oh, Sorden, not more loser. I said, no, his horses will improve. I backed you, because you could see it at the trials. Huge hat control, terrific.
Right.
And then I went back off that at Terrain. And I just said, he's also going to run well. Run better.
Yeah, you know? He's been training a number of winners out wide. I think they've been bobbing up.
And then the horse runs well in town as well, so.
Yeah. Well, there we go. So, no good there. And then Thursday night, I don't often back favourites one out, but I did. There was one that just stood out, Kentucky Flyer. It had dominant form in the race, and it needed to be ridden dominantly. Like, it couldn't afford either a sit sprint or other horses to get close to it. And Damien Lane, as he does, was happy just to sit outside the leader, and it was Chelsea McFarlane on a picnic horse, a 1,000-metre horse, and he let it out sprinting. It's Damien Lane is a terrific rider, but that is his one weakness. He's just not... He doesn't recognise when he's got... a dominant horse in a race and just owns the race.
Like Zara would have.
Yeah, Zara.
See, that's the difference between him and Zara.
That's the difference.
Champion jockeys, but in that situation, Zara's happy to up.
Just go. Yeah, totally. You know? That's the total difference between them. Now, on the other hand, when you put him on a stalker or a horse in the field, Damien Lane is just a magnificent rider. Did you see his ride on Master of Arts in Sydney on Saturday?
No, I didn't, but I saw it one. But
it was just a thing of beauty. I mean, he coaxed that horse. I mean, punters go and watch it. He probably hits the horse with the whip twice, and he almost conned that horse to going to the front. And
that's the sort of horse. But that comes with the territory of riding for Weir.
Yeah.
You know, and that's the same with Brad and things like that. And Weir generally, I mean, there's Cliff's Edge and whatnot, but generally he wants to be the hunter, not the hunted. He wants his horses ridden as the hunter to produce late, and that's where that comes in. But it's where Zara, he's a bit older, probably. He's probably, 5 years older than Damien Lane, maybe a bit more. But he's got that experience that he can balance it out to when he has to go early and use his initiative.
I really find when Mark Zara's on a dominant horse in the race, he just gets the job done.
Yeah.
Now, like, just...
And that's why that's so suited to Gallo Chop.
Yeah.
Because they're just perfect.
Yeah.
He's a horse who needs to be on pace. He hasn't got a big turn of foot, but he's got a sprint he can hold for a long way. So get going on him early.
One of the bigger bets I had last year was only at about 6-4 or something like that. Might have been 7-4. It was positively high at Sandown. Mm. Difficult horse to ride. I've been getting back, and he owned the race from the 1-1. You know what I mean? Like, and he can do it from the. So he'll just go wherever he has to go.
Yeah.
To make sure he doesn't care if he wins by a neck or two lengths.
Yeah.
And I think that's the key of those highly dominant riders that are happy to win by neck. You know.
Yeah.
So and then anyway, I started to turn things around by Friday night. Saturday was better, so we stopped the rot, and the week wasn't a disaster in the end. So.
Well, when I was sort of steadying my shit, I had that bad run, and then I got to a run where I was exactly the same thing. I was doing my money early in the week, and then chasing my tail into the weekend, and I was sort of salvaging, you know, and I was just trying to keep my legs together a bit earlier in the week, you know, and just sort of be a bit harder on the race I choose to bet in, because I just know just mentally getting into the juicy part of the week, you want to be sort of going forward, stepping into the ball rather than
totally.
You know,
Now I think exact subject. Okay, I think I got a bit loose last Tuesday. There was a race there that I thought the favourite was vulnerable, so I tried to just back a few fringe dwellers around it. You know, middle pinners, and it probably you're better off in the long run staying out of those sort of situations.
Yeah, I find I was leaking on that. I call that leakage. You know, that I was playing in that sort of thing where you want to be involved every day. You want to do something, but there's no harm in letting them go because there's going to be plenty more races. You know, the two meetings, Friday, Saturday, and things like that, later in the week, you know. So.
But from a psychological point of view, punters, the thing you've got to remember is not to ever try and blast your way back into the front. You just got to, if you do make some mistakes and get behind the game a little bit early in the week or whatever, you've just got to work your way back into it and not rush it. And just accept the results as they happen.
That's all they are, they're results.
Yeah.
You know, they're just events.
Yeah.
You know, and they're not random, but they're events and they're equations and. You know, sometimes they're going to fall your way, sometimes they're not, sometimes it's going to be your fault, sometimes it's not. You just have to let it balance out.
And for me, one of the important things I do is to keep really solid records. So you can always go back and look at the progression of your betting over time, and you can see when you've had bad runs and tributes, and then how you've worked your way back past that. You know what I mean?
Well, that was what I did a month ago. I said, I had a feeling. Every time this year I struggled. I don't know why. And so I went back and looked at my records for the last 5 years I've been doing it, and except for last year, the other 3 years was the same. Mm. Just had that 2 month or 8 week or that, and pretty much sometimes it was this time of year, and I'd always worked my way through it, and there it was back at following the results, picked up again, and you know, it's just a roller coaster, mate.
Now, my wife's always helpful, DK. I go, Jesus, funny things happening this week. I'm sort of in my office blowing up, saying, what's going on here?
Yeah.
There's stupid things happening. And she just yells out, it's a lunar retrograde. I go, okay. And a lot of these weird things seem to happen in these lunar retrograde. I take no notice of it. But the amount of times I say there's really strange things happening, and she goes, it's a lunar retrograde.
There you go.
I go, okay. So it's like some sort of thing where everyone's behaviour gets a little bit out of kilter.
Yeah.
I think maybe that can explain what's happened in South Africa, DK. They had a bit of a lunar retrograde over there.
Oh, have they? What? God, are you outraged? Potts, are you outraged? You've got to be out. Oh, no, you're not on Twitter. No point you being outraged unless you can just vent on Twitter and just spew it out.
Well, look, these players are going to cop what's coming to them. Right?
That's it.
And they've made their own bed. They're going to have to lie in it. But I'm not going to be part of the pile on DK. I really don't care, to be honest.
Is that part of... I think I'm the same place. I care about... I've got a 2-year-old, a 5-year-old, and a wife who look to me to, you know, provide for them and protect them. The rest of the stuff I don't really give a shit about, really. I mean, I follow the cricket, I follow the footy, but no, I'm not passionate to say I'm... You know, I hate Steve Smith for what he did. I'm vengeful and hate. It's disgust me, and it's... You know, it's just, I've got more important things to worry about. I've got to back a winner tomorrow, you know. And
some people want the death penalty.
Sky's falling in and, you know, I mean, fair enough. I get it all. The tradition's been sullied and all these sort of things, but we've been busted ball tampering. They're going to be penalised, you know, what is it, match fee and one game or whatever. That's what the ICC Level 2 charge is for ball tampering. I've seen it plenty of times before. It's just, it's like when the racing with the Smurden stuff, we all sort of go... You know, we've seen it all in the background, and there's bits and pieces, people getting buckled here for this and that, and then when it's on the front page of the paper with all the text messages like the Aquanita thing, it's shock horror. Oh, Jesus. Not our sport, you know, and this and that, tarnished and everything, and here we go, been buckled with the cameras, you know, and all this is this, and the premeditation and everything, that's probably the worst part, and same with the Smurden thing, the worst part was the premeditation, but, so that's my problem. I can see why people are outraged, but... Jesus, Twitter is dead set toxic for the last 24 hours. I mean,
I know it's a straight captain, but they've certainly got treated a lot more harshly than Robert Smurden and his crew really, haven't they? Anyway, whatever.
Yeah,
I do have a great bull story.
Tell us, Potts. Yes.
Right? So, Under 16s, and it's a 2-day game, right? Played over two Saturdays. So we batted first.
So just to let you know, I got that completely wrong, and we're
back in
the top 3.
Oh, beauty. Thanks, right, love.
Thank you. We're all sweet punters. So it's a 2-day game, played over two Saturdays. We've batted first, been bowled out with about half an hour to go or whatever in the first day.
You're playing? Well, you're playing?
Yeah, I'm the captain.
Captain, under 16.
Right. Pots. I could be ridiculed here on Twitter for...
And what sort of cricketer were you, Pots? Just where were you? Middle order bats? Were you open? Were you top order bowler?
I used to open the batting.
Open the batting?
For the lower grade teams.
Yeah.
I played in some really good teams where I was carrying the drinks.
Oh, yeah.
So I played with Michael Slater and,
oh, yeah. Oh, there you go.
And a few other Shield players, but yeah. I never got a game with that team.
Yeah.
But anyway, so this was just local club cricket, under 16s. I'm the captain. We've been bowled out. We bowled about 10 overs. And our coach was away for a couple of months. So what the club had done was arranged either a first or a second grader to come and look after us, one game each, right? So we had this bloke come from, I think it was from second grade, come and look after us. And it was like, you know, like club cricket, umpire your own.
Yeah.
Like the coach is umpire and everything, you know, no officials or anything. So anyway, Stump's first day, we all go home. And this bloke that was looking after us, his two passions in life were cricket and cars. And he had a panel beating business. Right. So end of the first day, we've packed the kid up, he's taking the kid home. During the week, I don't know what's got into his mind, but he's got the ball out and he's taken to it with the panel beating buffering equipment.
The buffer, I was going
to
say.
Anyway, so we turned up the game. Well, no, I said a clue. And yeah, 5 minutes before we get start. He's got this grin on his face like you wouldn't believe. And he's throwing the ball to me. One side of it looks like a Granny Smith. The other side looks like an old grape. Like, it was just unbelievable. I'm like, what are we
going to do? So you threw it to the bowler.
And dead set. Like, it's 9 o'clock in the morning, an overcast day, with a two-piece ball. It's been tampered with beyond belief. And the bowler couldn't land it on the pitch. It was swinging that far that I said, you're going to have to hold a cross seam to get it the game straight. Thankfully, we only got 3 overs in and it pissed with rain and everyone went home.
Yeah.
But it was the funniest thing I've ever seen.
The panel booting buffer. I can imagine him just trying to catch it.
The interesting part was, I think back on it all, we thought it was hilarious. And there was never any ramifications. No. I don't know if anyone... Because we were only 15 and 16, yeah. Right? So I don't know if any of the seniors were saying, you can't go doing things like that. It's the funniest thing.
Yeah, ever. Well, you didn't knock them over for 15 or 20 runs because of the rain, anyway.
Yeah. So ball tampering's been going on around cricket in one form or another, I think.
Since the first ball's ever been bowled.
And I think it's worth remembering that the South African captain's got a couple of charges himself, and he's still the captain. But anyway, I mean, let cricket can sort it out.
Yeah, they can sort it out, mate. We've got to worry about backing a winner tomorrow and the next day.
What happens. We've got anything else we can discuss here in
Golden Slipper? You have a look at what do you think?
Yeah, well, I mean, I didn't know the field that way, but I just felt compelled to have a bit of a bet because I knew it's like, you know, only the diamond, blue diamond side of it and had some feel for sunlight. And I ended up backing four horses and had something on the winner and won a few hundred on the race. Like it seemed like an easy horse to back, didn't it? The winner?
Yeah, well, it was the horse, the sunlight and written by were coming off, obviously, the. At some peaks and trying to get up again.
Yeah.
I think it was the horse and peaking for the race. And it was just that every time when I worked at Sportsbet, I always remembered that big debut win or the big return win. Then the trainer, Snowden's, Hawks, come off it. And a few of them got rolled. I don't know if Capitalist or was get rolled at $1.50 or $1.40.
Seed Boy, they get
rolled at that short price and it nearly got rolled. In the short price and whatever it was, that lead up. So what's the week before?
Smart Missile beat Seed Boy.
Yeah.
In that lead up, yeah.
Yeah. So they come off, they go over the short odds, and then they get them going for the grand final.
Yep.
And whoosh, and that's exactly what Hawks Gun said. People dropped off because it only was bashed to the line in that lead up race.
Yeah.
But Hawks said, don't worry about that. It's got 5 links up its sleeve to the gun.
There it is.
So. And but that's just good to see every year.
Good to see Team Hawks win a big race from a wide gate.
That's right.
There we go.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
That's the way
you use
a white gate. You just use it.
White gates are good. White gates are bad until they're good. You know? So you can cross the field and cruise. And,
yeah. And the inside drawers and the box seat is great until it's a disaster. Anyway, we'll be back in part two in a sec, punters.